Good morning, church. We can stand together.
Bible Chapel online. My name is Ramirez Moody, and I serve as the associate pastor of our Young Adults and Compassion Ministries at our Rolling Meadows campus, and I am so glad that you've joined us today. Whether you're new or you come every week, I want to invite you to check in. You can do that on this page through the link in the comments on YouTube and Facebook or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We'd love to know you're here, and as a staff, we count it a privilege to pray for you. So let us know how we could do that when you check in. We want to help you to faithfully worship the Lord through giving. Here are ways that you can give as an act of worship today. You can give online on this page, or you can use the QR code on this screen. You can give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, through a text, or simply by mailing your gift to the Rolling Meadows campus. We're remembering the Lord and His sacrifice for us through taking communion together in our service today. Take a minute now to get some juice, a cracker, or a piece of bread to prepare for this time of remembrance. Harvest, we want to continue to show the love of Jesus and partner with the City of Refuge and Chicago's West Side Police as they continue to provide baseball and basketball teams for the kids on Chicago's West Side. Over the past 3 years, crime has been down over 80% in these neighborhoods where these leagues are present. Right now, we're collecting new and gently used baseball cleats for kids and baseball gloves. Get all of the details at harvestnow.info. God continues to move powerfully in the lives of our young adults through Harvest Young Adults Ministry. If you're out of high school through your 20s, we want you to get connected with other young adults across our church. The next Young Adults Night is Thursday, June 24th at 6:30 p.m. Young Adults is going to be an awesome time. I hope to see you there. So go to harvestnow.info for more details. Last Saturday, hundreds of men across Chicagoland gathered for our men's event, Now to Him. We wanted you to see what God did in this event. Check this video out.
I believe that in this room, God has the men who can change the course and direction of families and communities and workplaces. I believe that as go the men of Harvest, so goes Harvest.
God is moving in the men of our church. Amen?
Doxological living is the only reasonable agenda for Christian manhood. So doxological living is simply living for the glory of God.
We would align our lives so that every aspect of it is for the praise, honor, and glory and worship of God. Now to Him. We are reflectors, men. We are reflecting to God honor and glory and praise.
Identity is our biggest hurdle to living doxologically. Glory for God is moved by our knowledge of our identity. The nearness of the truth about who you are and who I am will have everything to do with what we live for this weekend and next week and the next month and the next year and however many more days we get on this planet. Come now and receive this identity with us.
God really met with our men. And hey guys, mark your calendars for September 24th through the 26th for our fall men's retreat at Camp Harvest. After a few weeks away, we're returning to our study through the book of Ephesians today. I want to invite you to grab your Bibles and a notebook and get ready to dive into Ephesians chapter 4, verses 7 through 10 today. Will you join me in prayer? Lord, we thank you for another opportunity to come together and worship and open up your word together. We are so grateful to see you moving throughout the ministries in our church. It's such a blessing to see what you're doing here. And so God, as we continue to move in our service today, my prayer is that our worship is pleasing and acceptable to you. And we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen.
I have good news today. We're in the house of the Lord today. Wherever you come from today, whatever place, whatever walk of life, you're here right now. And I can tell you right now, the Lord is in this place and He offers freedom today. Come on. Sing it out.
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory.
That's how the chorus goes.
Life again, I rose with you. sing your praise forevermore. Sing praise to him. Sing out your praise to him.
Come on.
Sing praise to him. Sing out your praise to him.
Getting a little emotional here. I often think about what my life would be like if it wasn't for Jesus. Ooh. I often think about that. Where would it be? He's been so good to me. I don't know if we have any history people, who loves history? Who loves history? Oh, maybe just a percentage. I love history, and anytime I've ever gone to a place where there has been a great historical event, if I'm actually walking on the ground where that event took place, there's something that kind of awakens in me. It's like this heightened awareness, this like deep connection to the event, or it makes me just remember. It makes me think about the people that were there participating in the event, what they must have thought, what they were going through, what they suffered, how they suffered, what they accomplished. And in remembering, it just makes me appreciate that part of history so much more. And in the same way, I think about, sometimes a lot, sometimes not so much, but I think about the day that I decided to follow Jesus. It was in this room. This very room almost 20 years ago. And I see some of you from that era, yeah. And here's the thing, I had spent my teenage years, my early 20s, just really, really walking away from God, pushing God away, and it got to a point in my life where I could not go any further in my sin. And God brought me here. And it wasn't that he wanted to make me feel shame. He wanted me to be aware of the sinfulness in my life and how it was separating me from him. And he made me aware of who he was and what he did and how he suffered and how he died specifically for me by taking on my sin. That is why we come to the table of communion. We come to the Lord's table to repent. We come to the Lord's table to be restored. We come to the Lord's table to remember what he did for us. Isaiah 53 says, he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. So I want you to grab amen. That is the reality. So if you have made that decision to follow Christ, I want you to grab the elements. We're going to do an antiphonal, a reading. So I'll read a little, I'll pray a little, and then I want you to respond. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let's say this together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus, you are forgiven. Say this with me. In the name of Jesus, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." You can take and eat. When supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." He's been so good to us. Sing this chorus out with me. You've been so, so good. You've been so, so good to me. Won't you think where I would be if not for you, not for you. You've been so, so good that your voice is right. Not for you, not for you. so in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mysteries of faith. Let's read this together. Christ has died. Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Amen. Amen. I cast my mind to Calvary, and Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed. I have his stone, Messiah still, and all alone. Oh, praise. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Come on. shout of praise. Amen. Amen. I'm actually out of breath. It's so good to worship with you. You guys can take a seat.
Hey, good morning. I think I mentioned this before. Don't applaud before. You just never know what's going to happen. It could be really bad. So, hey, can we turn these lights a little bit lower for me so that I'm not blinded up here? This way I can see your faces. And is it bright enough out there? Thank you very much. Is it bright enough for you to see your Bibles? Good. Okay, good. Anyway, it's great to be back with you. It's been a few weeks. I finished my real job for the year since we were together last, because I teach at Moody Bible Institute. Have you heard of that? I hope so. Anyway, I teach at Moody, and I got my grades in, and it's like a weight off my shoulder, and now summer has begun, so happy. That's why teachers teach, I've always heard. You know, June, July, and August, the three top reasons. But no, I actually love the teaching part of it. It's the grading I hate, and so that's done, and I'm glad. Anyway, it's good to be back with you after a few weeks, and just a few more times. That's it. And I've been grateful for the chance. I want to say hello to everyone out all the different Harvest campuses. I'm so glad that we can be together via technology. I can see all of you out there. I'm just looking at the camera. I can see through it, and so I'm glad to see all of you. Anyway, it's good to be back. A few weeks ago, it was Eva and I had our 45th anniversary. Isn't that amazing? Now, this is something to applaud about. This is the miracle of it. Eva's only 39. So, I don't know how we did that, but it's... Now, what I discovered through the years that it's really tough for me to figure out what gift to give. Do you guys, anybody have trouble giving gifts? Yeah, it's like, what in the world do I give? And so it really shouldn't be that hard for me, because anything I ever give Eva, she loves. It's just what I wanted. Well, I just didn't know what to get you, so I got you this major commentary on Ephesians based on the Greek text. I love it. It's just what I wanted. You know, I've been really wondering what to give you. So I bought this brand new lawnmower. Oh, I thought you really needed that. It's just what I wanted. So Eva's really easy to buy gifts for, because she likes anything I give her. I know we all struggle with figuring out what gifts to give. But I have good news today. And that is that we have all already received a gift, at least one. That's perfect for us, for each one of us. We may not know what to give, but God knows what to give us. And we have all received at least one gift that's perfect. We may not even know what it is yet, but we have a perfect gift from the Lord. How do we know they're perfect? Because the giver of the gifts is perfect. And he knows our hearts and our needs and what is best for us. And so, obviously, I'm speaking right now about spiritual gifts. Today, we're going to talk about unwrapping spiritual gifts from the Lord who knows us so well. This continues from about Ephesians 4, 7 through the end, through about verse 16, but we're going to look at 4, 7 through 10 today. It begins the process of unwrapping the gifts. And what I'd like to do is just read this brief passage to you. And this is what we're going to do. We're going to stand up to honor God's word, get out our Bibles. Please follow along as I read Ephesians 4, 7 through 10. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Messiah's gift. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he had descended into the lower regions, the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above the heavens, that he might fill all things. You can have a seat. This passage deals with the dispensing of the gifts. Next week, 11 through 16 deals with the distribution of those gifts, but this is how the Messiah gave us the gifts. I want to start by saying that we need balance when discussing spiritual gifts, because there's two extremes, and I'm sure you recognize them. I call them the misusers and the refusers. Those are the two extremes that we see, the misusers and the refusers. What do the misusers do? They seek all the gifts. They are just absolutely committed. I want all the gifts, even some that are not in the Bible. I want all of them. And then they emphasize particularly sensational gifts. There's a great emphasis on things that are just explosive and wild and miraculous and an emphasis on the sensational. And there's absolutely no control over what it is that they are doing. If it's a gift, it's a gift, and just do whatever you want. No control. And then also no limits. You can do anything and say it's a spiritual gift. So that's the misusers of the gifts as they are in the Bible. Then there's the refusers. The refusers are those who basically say, stop using the gifts. We're scared of these. These are dangerous. Stop. Also, they deny that there are spiritual gifts completely. Now, I want to say, I believe that some gifts have ceased. I'm not going to lie to you. I think there are some gifts that were temporary in nature and some that are permanent. But sometimes people who deny some of the gifts say, stop, don't even worry about the gifts, don't think about the gifts, don't use the gifts, and they deny them all. And it becomes over-controlling in some ways. If you're going to even think about using your gifts, they have to be controlled to such an extent that no one has any liberty in the Lord. There's an over-control, and it's completely limited. In fact, to the point where sometimes people won't operate in the realm of the gifts. Now, here's what I think. In these two extremes, there's obviously a little truth in each of them, and the best thing to do is to come into the middle and have a balanced view of spiritual gifts. And this church has historically always had a very balanced view of spiritual gifts, for which I'm grateful. And that's what I'm going to try and present. Let's talk about a definition of spiritual gifts since we're talking about them. A spiritual gift is God's endowment of a particular enablement. It's supernatural. It's an endowment of a particular enablement given to each and every believer, at least one of them, to empower service for the Lord, to empower service for him. God wants us to use these gifts to serve him. He gives them to us. It's a supernatural. The way I would think of it is it's related to the idea of a talent, okay? You have a talent. When you're born, you're given a talent. You may not know what it is yet. I tried to learn how to play piano, zero talent. No, I mean, it was awful. But my son, when he was six years old, he sat down and he had this teacher, and all of a sudden he's playing Billy Joel music, 6 years old. In the middle of the night. I'm like, what? Because he had talent. He was born with it, but it took till he was about 6 years old for it to start coming out. When we are born again, God gives us an enablement. It's a spiritual gift. Some are public gifts. Some are more private, service-oriented gifts. But God gives them to us, generally speaking, I would say, when we're born again, when we come to know the Lord. We may not know what it is, but then as we grow in the faith, they come out, and we get to use them to serve him. So that's what this is about. There are four major passages about the gifts in the New Testament. There's Romans 12, there's 1 Corinthians 12 through 14, 1 Peter 4, 10, 11, and this passage, Ephesians 4, 7 through 16. We're just gonna focus on Ephesians 4, 7 through 10 today about God's dispensing of the gifts. And to begin with, in verse 7, this is saying that every individual follower of Jesus, every individual believer has received at least one spiritual gift. I hope that's encouraging to you. You may think, well, everyone else is gifted, but not me. No, every one of us has at least one spiritual gift. This passage says it in verse 7. It says, but grace was given to each one of us. And that's talking about one spiritual gift. I want to make four observations about verse 7. First, God maintains the unity of the body through diversity, not uniformity. God maintains the oneness of the body, the complete whole of the body, the oneness of the body through different gifts, not giving us all the same gift. It's diversity, not uniformity. The contrast, I think, is right here. You see in verse 7, it starts with the word but. That's a contrast. In contrast to the above verse, where there's one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all, you know, that's unity. But in contrast, he gives different gifts to everyone. So verse 6 is emphasizing our unity. Verse 7 is emphasizing the each one of us aspect, the diversity that we have, each having different gifts. And this is so that we can do the work of service, you'll see in verse 12 later on. Now, I tend to go to Israel. Have you heard of that? Yeah. I hope you'll think about joining Mike Van Lanningham and me when we go to Israel in about a year and a half in a harvest trip to Israel. It's going to be great. You can sign up now. But one of the things I saw in Israel that I think is kind of funny is there's a guy that leads tours to Israel, and he's kind of well known, so I won't say his name. But anyway, when he sends a group to Israel, brings a group to Israel, he sends out a letter and tells them how to dress. So one night I go to the Western Wall, and I see about 50 people. They all have tilly hats. They all have these hiking shirts that you roll up the sleeve, or you can roll it down. They have these hiking pants that you can zip off and turn them into shorts. They all are dressed identically. And I thought, what is this, some cult? The cult of the hikers has come to Jerusalem? And I asked, and I figured out, they all got the memo that they were supposed to dress that way. And for 12 days, that's how they dressed in Israel every day, which I think is hysterical. I don't know how, I guess maybe it makes it easy to make sure you've got your group together, you know. But that's what it would look like if we all had the same gift. We'd all look the same, we'd all act the same. There would only be one ministry in a congregation. But as it is, we all have different gifts and we can actually complement each other. That's what Paul's point is in 1 Corinthians 12. We're not all hands, we're not all feet, right? We need a diversity of gifts to have a full ministry so that we don't look like each other, so we can minister in all the ways that are necessary. So that's the first observation. God maintains the unity of the body through diversity. The second thing it says here in verse 7, but grace was given to each one of us. This is that God not only calls us to serve him, but gives us the divine enablement to do so. God doesn't just say, I want you to be my representatives, my servants, my workers here. I'm going to help you do that by giving you a spiritual gift. He gives us divine enablement. You see, it says grace was given to each one of us. When we see the word grace, we automatically think it means undeserved favor, right? How many have ever heard that definition? undeserved favor, undeserved kindness. That's the automatic definition. God's riches at Christ's expense. I'm sure you've heard that, right? That's not what it always means. Okay. The word grace can mean thanks. That's why we say grace over a meal, right? So it doesn't always mean undeserved favor. It can mean thanksgiving. And then it also can mean, and very often in the New Testament, it means enablement, empowerment. Paul prays three times for the thorn in the flesh to be removed from him. And the divine answer to him is, my grace is sufficient for you. That means my divine enablement is sufficient for you. That's what it means. And so here, that's what it means as well. It says each one has been given grace. It refers to a spiritual gift. In fact, the word that's used in other passages, like in 1 Corinthians 12, or in Romans 12:6, where it's translated gifts. Now, concerning gifts, it literally has the word grace in it, charismata, grace gifts. And this is related to that, the idea of divine enablement. So this is saying each one of us has been granted some sort of divine enablement. You know, I teach a course in biblical interpretation, and I give a lot of work. It's why students are like, well, I could learn something, but I mean, I might have to work at this, and they're a little scared to take me because the reputation has gone out, a lot of work. I give assignments on every genre of scripture where they have to do a worksheet besides all the other work in the course. They're constantly having to work. And one of the things is they have to figure out how to interpret a narrative and how to interpret poetry or a wisdom section. And here's the thing that I really believe I need to do before I give them the assignment. And students, they want to do their assignments ahead so they don't have a lot of homework. They just want to, and I say, no, don't do the homework because I need to teach you first. I need to give you the tools for you to do that assignment. They don't like that. They just want to do the assignment without the tools. Well, I think as a teacher, I'm responsible to give them the tools before they do the assignment. Well, do you know what God says to us? I've given this universal body, all these individual followers of Jesus, an assignment to serve me in communities. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to give them the tools to carry it out first. So that doesn't mean that we should only operate or serve God with our gifts, but it does mean that God will make us far more effective, and he has given us the tools so that we can serve him effectively. That's why God has given us each at least one gift so we can have divine enablement to serve him. Here's a third observation. God not only gives the gifts, but he gives them in different measures. See that in verse 7? Grace was given to each one according to the measure of Messiah's gift. There's a different measure according to the measure of the gift. This explains why different people can have the same gift but have different levels of effectiveness. So I actually believe that I have three gifts and one of them is evangelism. Okay? I believe that God has given me a particular ability, spiritual gift, not because it's anything in me, but his gift, that I can explain the gospel clearly and bring people to a decision. Also, I am able to teach others, this is the other part of the gift of evangelism, teach others how they can communicate their faith and present the good news to others. That's part of the gift of evangelism. But I'm no Billy Graham. I don't understand the gift that Billy Graham has. I've mentioned this once before. Billy Graham gets up, he preaches a very mediocre message, to be honest. He's with the Lord now, he knows. And he does it, a very simple but mediocre message. He does it with an accent that people laugh at. At least Erwin Lutzer does a really great impression of it. And then he says the buses will wait, and what happens? People get up and they move to the front, and masses of people come to know the Lord. I came to know the Lord at a Billy Graham movie. And they had a little clip of him preaching too. I'd never heard of him before. That was like, wow. Anyway, the point of it is it's a different measure of the gift. He has a powerful, had a powerful gift of evangelism. I have a little gift of evangelism. Different measures, different measures. And not only that, even the gifts we have different measures. I do have the gift of evangelism, but it's this. Then I have another gift. I believe it's teaching. It's about that, okay? I think that's my strongest gift. You guys apparently don't have the gift of learning because you haven't figured out what I'm saying. No, that's not true. No, I think teaching is my gift, my main gift. And then I have the gift of evangelism. And then I have a really little gift of leadership, okay? Those are my three biblical gifts. And you see what I'm saying is there's some gifts that I have in a greater measure, some in a lesser measure, and then just in a tiny measure. And then there's other things I do without a gift, just because I'm being obedient to serve God. Don't have the gift of administration. Not at all. But I still have to serve God in some ways. I coordinate a program at Moody. I'm the Jewish studies professor there. I coordinate a major. And so, therefore, I have to do some administrative tasks. Not my gift, but I've got to do it. But the point is, he gives us gifts in different measures. What's your gift? Do you know? I hope you do. And do you know if you have several or how much of a measure of that gift you have? Here's the fourth observation. God's gift giver is the Messiah, Jesus himself. It says here, the measure of Christ's gift. This means that he is the source of our gifts. You could translate it according to the measure of the gift of Christ or the gift of the Messiah. He is the source of our gifts. Now, I think this is really important to understand. Beware of trying to manipulate God to give you a gift or to say, I have a gift that God didn't give me, okay? He is the source, the Lord Jesus himself. He's the source of our gifts. He gets to determine what gift we have. We can't manipulate him. We can't force him to give us a gift. I learned this really quickly when I was a new follower of Jesus. There was this man that was really pressuring me to get a particular gift. You need this power from God. He said, I was kind of dumb. I listened to him. He said, there's going to be a great revival in New York City, but you'll only be able to participate if you have this gift. I wanted the gift. And they kept praying for me to get this gift. I wouldn't get it. Didn't happen. And then they said, we're going to pray through. It was like one of those really long nights. We were down in Greenwich Village. I was in a basement flat. They're all laying hands on me, praying for me to get a particular gift. They're going to force God to give me this gift. Nothing. Then all of a sudden, someone says, I know why he's not getting the gift. He's demon-possessed. I'm like, what? They want to start casting demons out of me. We had had a late night dinner, and they brought a bag over me, and they were thumping me on the back, and I said, what's the bag for? They said, when the demon comes out, you're going to vomit. I thought, I'm going to vomit because this lady here is punching me on the back. That's why I'm going to vomit. I just ate. I was done. I was done with that. From now on, I thought, I'm never going to try and press God to give me any gift. He's given me the gift. I just need to discern what it is. I mean, you can pray. I'm not saying you can't pray for a particular gift, but never, ever, ever. We should never try to force God's hand to give us a particular gift. It's his decision. It's his decision. So Here's what I'm saying. Everyone has at least one spiritual gift. Secondly, the Lord Jesus dispenses spiritual gifts as an outgrowth of his victory over Satan, sin, and death. In verse 8, it has a quotation from Psalm 68. When he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. He gave gifts to men. This quotation depicts, this is from Psalm 68, it depicts a divine king dispensing gifts to his people. That's the imagery that you get. He ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. This is an extremely problematic verse to be quoting here. Why? First of all, it may or may not really be, and it probably isn't, a direct prophecy of the Lord Jesus. It's an application of what happens when a divine king has a victory and then dispenses the gifts. There's also a whole bunch of ways that this quotation differs from the Old Testament text. One scholar, Harold Honer, my old professor, he mentions in his commentary 6 ways that it differs from the actual verse in the Old Testament. Well, what's the point? I think that what we have here is a paraphrase. There's another problem with this verse, and it's this. It uses the word, he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. But the problem is, in the original verse in the book of Psalms, Psalm 68, 18, it says he received gifts. And here it says he gave them. So people think Paul changed it just to make it fit his message. I don't think so. I did a word study on that Hebrew word that's translated receive or take in Psalm 68, 18. And it often means to take so you can give. So Paul is just reading it that way. It means to receive gifts so you can give them away. And you see that later on in Psalm 68. It talks about how in that psalm he gave to his people. At the end of the chapter, here, let me turn to that. It says at the end of Psalm 68 that he is the one who gives power and strength to his people. So he receives gifts to give them to us. And that's why Paul just goes right to the giving the gifts. Here's what this verse is just saying. It's saying just as there is a king in the Old Testament who receives captives and receives gifts and then gives them to his people, so our king has won a great victory. He has taken captive sin, Satan, death itself. He is the victor. He has received everything as victor, all the spoils, and now he shares them with us. That's what this is saying. That's why the Lord Jesus has the authority to give us spiritual gifts. He can dispense them because he is the great victor. He is the winner. He is the victorious king. Secondly, this explanation of Psalm 68 declares the significance of the incarnation and ascension of the Messiah Jesus. Look at verse 9. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower regions, some say of the earth, this says lower regions of the earth, and that's the best translation. Before his ascension, the Messiah Jesus had to descend to the earth. This is a reference to the incarnation, that God the Son became a man. A lot of people want to say that it's a reference to going to hell. But when it says he descended to the lower parts, it should be translated even the earth. It's called the genitive of apposition, if you want to know the Greek, but we use it all the time. We say, what? I don't know what apposition is. It's okay. You ever talk about the city of Chicago? That's a genitive of apposition. The city, namely, the city of Chicago. Here it says he descended to the lower parts, namely, the earth. That's the incarnation. That's the idea. Before he could ascend, he had to descend. He had to become a man. God became a man. And then secondly, having descended and died, he was resurrected, and now he can ascend far above the heavens. That's what it says here in this verse. In saying this, he who descended is the one who also ascended far above the heavens. That means the highest heaven, the most exalted place of heaven, that he might fill all things. His ascension marked Jesus' victory over the grave. He took his rightful place at the right hand of the Father. He is in the highest heaven, and then he dispenses gifts beginning at Pentecost through the Holy Spirit. And he then will use gifted people here, those who he's given gifts, and look what it says, that he might fill all things, to fill all the earth with his message and his power. He's going to fill all things. How is he going to do that? Through the gifted people he's given gifts. In other words, on earth, he has empowered us spiritually with his gifts so that we can accomplish his purposes throughout the world in all things. We are his representatives. We are his ambassadors. He has empowered us to be that way. I once, I'm from New York City, you may have heard. I was serving with a Jewish ministry, Chosen People Ministries in New York. I went to my very first staff meeting, and it was in Manhattan. And we had to wear tie and jacket to our meetings back then. Forget about it. But anyway, I did. And then afterwards, I stopped on the Upper West Side to the famous gourmet shop called Zabar's to buy coffee. And I was just walking around Zabar's, looking around. And all their clerks there were ties and jackets. And so some woman comes up to me and she starts asking me where she can find something. I'm like, oh, I don't work here. Really? You dress so nice. I said, thank you. She says, what do you do? Well, I didn't want to say I am an outreach worker with Chosen People Ministries because I thought that this woman would then get really mad at me. So I wanted to break it to her gently. So I said, I'm an ambassador, which is normal in New York because you've got the UN there. There's all sorts of ambassadors. She says, oh, really? Really, you're an ambassador? I said, yes. She said, for whom? Meaning what country? I said, for a king. She said, what country? I said, a Middle Eastern country. I am here representing him doing his work. And she said, what work is that? I said, he wants me to tell you all about him. Do you want to hear about him? She said, sure. And I got to tell her about the Lord Jesus. And it was a great conversation. That's what this means about how he gave gifts to us to fill all things. We are his representatives. He has gifted us to be his representatives to accomplish everything he wants to accomplish on the earth. Each and every one of us are his ambassadors, his representative right here on earth. And that's how he's going to accomplish it. That's why he gives us spiritual gifts. This little paragraph here, here's what it's saying. Our victorious King has given us all the spiritual enablement we need to serve and glorify him. That's the simple message of this little paragraph. Our King has won. He is the victor, and he has the authority to empower us so we can glorify him and do everything he wants. Isn't that encouraging? Doesn't it make you want to serve him? He hasn't left us out there, do what can. No! He's called us to serve him and said, and by the way, here's the gifting to do it. So, now what? Our victorious King has given us spiritual gifts to serve and glorify him. How do we discover those gifts? How do we do it? I want to make several suggestions for how to discover our gifts. First, study the gifts in several key passages. They are listed in the notes. If you ever look at the notes, there are Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12 through 14, 1 Peter 4, 10 and 11, and Ephesians 4, 7 through 16. You may want to use a book. Here's the problem I think about using a book if you're going to study about spiritual gifts. I look up books about spiritual gifts all the time. They're all bad. They're either about, they're arguing over, do they continue or do they cease? Or do some continue and do some? They're just arguing. They're not really talking about how to deploy the gifts that we have. I said that to Eva, and I was trying to think about putting a book down. And the only book I know of that I think is really good to help you is out of print, but I'll mention it, Unwrapping the Gifts, Unwrapping Spiritual Gifts by Ken Gangel, G-A-N-G-E-L. It's out of print, but you can find it on Amazon. I think there's a reprint of it for about $4. But it's a nice little book, Unwrapping Spiritual Gifts, Ken Gangel. But mostly the books are bad. I said, oh, wow, maybe I should write a book about spiritual gifts. Someone might read it. Or maybe there's no books about it that are out there because no one wants to read about it. I don't know. So, but study the passages. See if you can identify the gifts through those passages. Secondly, take a gift inventory or a gift assessment. There actually is a gift assessment that you can use right on the heart. I didn't know this till today, believe it or not. Sherry Smith happily told me that there is a gift assessment right on the Harvest website. Now, I would have taken this gift assessment to see how what I think of it, but I didn't know about it till this morning. But I'm really glad that there is a gift assessment. They are very helpful. They're not perfect. Gift assessments are not perfect, but they are helpful. Here's what I found. Sometimes, and I don't know about this one on Harvest, I suspect this is not the case, but I've seen gift assessments that list gifts that aren't in the Bible. I once knew someone that took a gift assessment, and he found out that he had the gift of youth work. There is no gift of youth work in the Bible. That's a ministry, but it's not a gift. So that's a problematic thing. Sometimes, and I think this is mistaken, some gift assessments I've seen have the gift of prophecy being the gift of preaching. That's inaccurate. So I would just caution you, a gift inventory is maybe helpful, but here's the greatest weakness of a gift inventory. We can skew the test. What we can do is we can say, this is the gift I want, so we answer the questions in a way that it will show that that's the gift we have. And there, you know, I heard a guy that said he had the gift of teaching because he took it on a gift assessment, and yet he taught a Bible study that only one person came to. Everyone was invited. People would come. They'd hear it one time, and then they'd say, no, not going back. I don't think he really had the gift of teaching. But he wanted it, so he skewed the assessment so that it would appear like he has the gift of teaching. So I would just be cautious. Use it, but don't take it as the final word. Third way to find a gift, identify our desires and inclinations. So, for example, if I have a passion to teach God's word, an inclination to do that, and I have to tell you, I became a believer in April, and then by July, I was teaching. I just wanted to do it so badly that anything I learned, I taught to anyone that would listen. And I don't think that just came because I just like being the center of attention or something like that. Rather, I just wanted to teach what I just learned. I had a burden in the biblical prophetic mold of, it's bubbling up, I've got to tell, I've got to teach. So that's how I know I had this inclination. Some people have a burden or this desire to serve, to do things behind the scenes and make them happen. That's a gift in the Bible. Find your inclination and listen to that. Now, it doesn't mean it's your gift, but it might be leading you to your gift. Fourth, receive guidance and confirmation from a mature believer that knows you well. When I came to faith, there was a man that was discipling me, just a wonderful, godly man, Dan. And he heard me communicate my faith, present the good news to someone very early in my walk. And he took me aside and he said, "You have the gift of evangelism, but you did it really bad." He says, "The only reason that that worked was because you have the spiritual gift. I'm gonna teach you how to do a better job of it." And he did teach me about how to share my faith, how to present the gospel, how to be clear, all these different things that are really important. So when you have a gift, you can improve on it. But what it was is, here's a mature believer who looked at me as a young man trying to do what God called me to do, and he identified something right away, and he helped me with it. Get counsel from people. We all should have someone who's a mature believer who knows us well that could give us some idea. Now I'm going to give you my key way of finding a spiritual gift. Are you ready? Practice the Eureka principle. Practice the Eureka principle. Here's how it works. It starts by serving in as many ways as possible. You see, because we are called to serve God, not just with our gifts. We should serve in every way possible. Here's what I mean. Every one of us is called to fulfill the Great Commission, not just those with the gift of evangelism, right? We all have to be those. Every one of us is called to give sacrificially to God. Yet there are some who have a spiritual gift of giving. They can even do it more so. But we all have to give. There are all kinds of ways we can serve God, and what we need to do is make ourselves available to serve God in as many ways as we can. Volunteer, do what you can. That's the first step. Serve in as many ways as possible, because that's a matter of faithfulness. Then secondly, see those areas in which there's the most effectiveness and joy. It's like in the movie Chariots of Fire, when the guy says, "When I run, I feel his pleasure." Right? I used to think, "When I run, I feel pain." But here's the thing. When we are serving in our giftedness, there's an ease of it. There's a joy that comes with it. Like, yes, this is what I was born for. So as we're serving in as many areas as possible, we're gonna find those areas where, yes, we have that ease and joy that comes with it. And then third, shout Eureka when you find what that gift is. Say, yes, this is what I have a special enablement to do. We had this dear friend when I was leading a congregation in New York, and she was invited to substitute teach for Eva, a class of fourth graders and fifth graders. And she was like, "I don't know, I've never taught before." Eva said, "Well, I'll give you the curriculum, I'll show you what to do." And so she said, "Okay." And she wasn't doing it because it was her gift, she was doing it because she wanted to be faithful. And the most amazing thing happened. She taught that class of 9 and 10-year-olds, and she came back and said, "This is what I was born to do. This is it, I love this." And she just was so effective as a teacher. Now I've watched her for 30 some years, and she can teach any age group, 9 and 10-year-olds, 90-year-olds, 30-year-olds. She can teach anyone because she is so gifted by God in this area. That's the Eureka principle. She made herself available for service. She found that area where she said, "This was easy." Now, there are some things we have to do that are not easy. We still have to be faithful. But when we find that area, let's make that a focus of our ministry. We celebrate, "Eureka, I found it." Well, God has gifted us, enabled us to serve him effectively. Someone once complained to D.L. Moody that he ought not to preach because he fractured the King's English every time he spoke. Mr. Moody responded by saying, "I'm using all that I have for the Lord. What are you doing?" God has gifted us to serve him. It may not be the gift we wanted. It may not be the gift that we think is the best. but it's what God has called us to use to serve him, in every way we can, but especially in those areas of giftedness. What are we doing with the gifts that he's given us? Are we serving him? I hope so. Father, we commit ourselves to you. Some of us know what our gift is and we haven't been using it. Lord, we commit ourselves to using it for you. Some of us don't know what our gifts are and we haven't been serving. Lord, we commit ourselves to serving you faithfully regardless. God, some of us want to know desperately what our gifts are, so we will ask you to reveal it to us. Show us what those gifts are so we can serve you more effectively. God, most of all, we want you to get the glory from our service to you, not us. We want you to be honored. Thank you for our Lord Jesus, who is a victorious King, who shared these gifts with us so that we can honor you by using them. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Messiah. Amen.
We'll sing your praise, we'll sing your praise, we'll sing your praise forever. We'll lift your name, we'll lift your name, Jesus.
To be in God's Word together today. We want to invite you back next Sunday morning at 9 and 11 o'clock Central Time. If you're ready and you live in the Chicagoland area, we would love to see you in person at one of our campuses next Sunday. And Harvest, remember, you are loved.